please stand and join in singing with me.
Approaching Jerusalem at Bethpage and Bethany near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it, and if anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it, and we'll send it back immediately here.' Then they went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, 'What are you doing untying the colt?' They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches as they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, 'Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest.' Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12.
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever.
Let Israel say, "His steadfast love endures forever. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord."
This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it.
I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone.
This is the Lord's doing. It is a marvel. It is marvelous in our eyes.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success.
Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord.
We bless you from the house of the Lord.
The Lord is God.
And he has given us light.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
Sweet Hosanna, sweet. the sun dawns this morning, there is something in the air. There is something different. There is something unexpected about to happen, and we sense it in Jesus' journey, the journey that he has made with us. For today, Jesus, after his life of ministry, makes his way toward the holy city of Jerusalem. And this prophet and sage who has wandered in the wilderness for years now comes to the center of where all religious life is practiced, where all the powerful and the mighty have gathered. And he enters, and the people cry out for him as their savior. And yet he comes in on a colt, in humility, something very unexpected. And on this Palm Sunday, we remember that day, a day that was a parade and a welcome and a celebration, but a day then as now that draws us into the most sacred week of the year, which we call Holy Week. Indeed, the children love a parade, and we invite them now.
I'd like to invite the kids to come down and spend a little time with me this morning.
Good morning. How are you guys today? Are you good? Good morning, Ann. Hi, Julia. Hi, sweetie. Can you guys do me a favor? Can we make a circle so I can look at your beautiful faces this morning? Can you come and sit here by Al?
Hey, bud.
Thomas, you can scoot in. I'm not going to bite, I promise.
Hey, buddy.
Okay, maybe just a little bit.
Hi.
Good morning, everybody. You can come in a little closer. It's hard to talk so far away. I'm going to scoot down here. How are you guys this morning? Good? Are you really good or are you kind of good? Good, good? Are you good, good? You're tired? I know you slept on my couch last night. I know you're tired. Are you good? Are you guys good? Are you good? Are you having spring break yet? Are you on vacation? Well, then you should be really, are you on spring break? Are you? Just starting or just getting over? Just starting. You should be really good then, right? You should be like, woohoo, I'm great. Are you on spring break too? Yes. Spring break is a lot of fun. You guys going to do anything cool for spring break? No? Clean your rooms? Do your laundry? Catch up on your homework? No? Play? Hang out with your friends? Eat all the food in the house? Sounds like a good spring break to me. I want to know something. Do you guys ever go to parades? Do you go to parades? Do you go to parades? You guys go to parades? Anybody go out there go to parades? Yes. What do you love about a parade, Al? What's the favorite thing you get to do at a parade? Get candy. Yep. Candy's pretty cool. What do you like to do when you go to parades? See the floats? What do you like to do at a parade? Get the candy? Do you get a lot of candy? Do you share your candy with your parents? No? Just keep it all to yourself? Yeah. What about the bands? Anybody like the bands? The music that they play. Pastor Steve likes the bands. He actually played in a band in the parades. What about the clowns? Do you love the clowns? No. What is it with clowns these days? Nobody likes clowns. They're kind of scary, aren't they? Yeah, they're kind of creepy, but they still are in the parades. Well, parades are a really fun thing, I think, to do, especially like on the 4th of July when we're celebrating our country's birth. But there was a parade a long, 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 long time ago. Do you see what's up on our altar up there? See what's up there, all that green stuff? Anybody know what, do you know what that is, Al? You know what's, anybody know what's up there? What's up there? Palm leaves. Do you know why there are palm leaves up there? It's Palm Sunday. It is. Do you know what Palm Sunday is all about? Not at all. Nope. Well, Palm Sunday happened many, many, many years ago, long time before even I was born, that long ago. Wow. 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 A long time ago. Palm Sunday was first celebrated about 2,000 years ago when Jesus, you know who he is, right? Tall guy, big beard, right? Jesus, he had been out in the countryside and he had been teaching and he had been preaching and he'd been with his disciples. And he was going into a big, huge city because he was going to do some more preaching and teaching there. And the people were so excited to hear him and to see him. You guys ever go to a concert? Yeah? You know how excited you get to see somebody when you're going to go to a concert? Well, it was kind of like that. They were so excited, and they knew Jesus was coming into Jerusalem. And Jesus, they thought, was going to come riding on this great big horse because they thought that he was just this awesome guy and he was just going to be like larger than life. But you know what he came into Jerusalem on? A little tiny donkey. They were so surprised. They were like, holy cow, who is this guy? Why is he coming in on a tiny donkey? But do you know that the message that he had been preaching and teaching about, and the message that he was going to tell all the people about in Jerusalem, was that the people didn't have to be all puffed up and they didn't have to be rich and they didn't have to be really intelligent to understand about God's love. That God's love was for everybody, even the lowliest, even the poorest, even the littlest. God's love was for everybody, and that was the message he was bringing into Jerusalem that day. And they were so excited to hear about it that they took their cloaks, their coats, they were called their cloaks, but we think of them as coats, and they took their palms because they wanted to wave this wonderful person that was coming into Jerusalem, because what they knew about him was a message that they needed to hear for their lives. They wanted to know about God's love, and they wanted to share God's love. And so they were singing this wonderful Hosanna in the highest. They were so happy. That's what they said back then. We would say, woohoo, Jesus is here today. But they said back then, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of God to tell us about God's love. And we say, woohoo, Jesus is coming to tell us about God's love. And every year since that time to this time, we remember about this very, very special parade. And that's why we have palms. But if we're going to do the woohoo, can you say woohoo with me? Woohoo. Okay, that's not a woohoo. Woohoo! Can you woohoo with me? Woohoo! Can you all woohoo? Woohoo! Awesome. All right, so what we're going to do is we need to give everybody a woohoo out here, but they need to have a palm to woohoo with. I'm going to ask Thomas if he'll go get our palms. And would you all help me hand out our palms this morning to the folks out there? And while we're doing that, they are going to sing a song called The King of Glory Comes. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I'm going to ask you all to stay seated while Pastor Steve and Jan helps us to sing. And once you get your palms, I want you to wave them because you, even if you don't know it yet, are very excited about Palm Sunday. All right? So we are going to have you all sing with us King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and it's up there on the screen. And these guys will lead us while we give you some palms to wave.
Jesus is coming. Woohoo! Woo-hoo! Let us pray. Hey, God. Hey, God. It's me.
It's me.
Thanks, God.
Thanks, God.
For sending your son, Jesus Christ,
into our lives.
To help us to know.
To help us to know.
The love that you have.
The love that you have.
For us.
For us.
For our church.
For our church.
For our community.
For our community.
And our world.
And our world.
Hey, God.
God.
Be with us.
Be with us.
This week.
This week.
This holy week.
This holy week.
Be with us.
Be with us.
And guide us.
And guide us.
Support us.
Support us.
And lead us.
And lead us.
And we say in our out loud voice, with one voice, Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Thanks for helping, guys.
We're going to keep us singing in response to the good news of Jesus as our Savior.
And it's the song is called He Has Made Me Glad. It may or may not be familiar to you. Julie's going to play it through once. The words are there if you need it in your songbook. It's 2270. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart, and I will enter his courts with praise. Sing together.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. I will say this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has made me glad. I will rejoice for he has made me glad. He has made me glad.
I invite us to continue to hear from God's holy word this morning, and this is a letter from the Apostle Paul written to the Philippians that begins in the second chapter at the fifth verse. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, Jesus humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. May God add blessing to the hearing of this holy word. Well, I too, as many of you, love a parade. Always have loved parades from the time I would sit in my front porch awaiting the parade that came down South Broadway Street as a child in Stanley, Wisconsin, to the time when I got to march in parades with my Eau Claire Memorial High School marching band, all 265 strong of us. One of my favorite memories actually was the year we were marching in the homecoming parade across the Water Street Bridge. All of us so perfectly in step, all 265 of us, that officials had to come running after us and tell us to stop marching, to walk across the bridge, because our in-step marching was causing the bridge to sink so much they were worried for its safety. Of course, we know that the 4th of July parade in Milton is one of the high points of the year. However, I have only walked in the Milton 4th of July parade. I've never seen it, and let me tell you, it's a much different perspective walking in the parade than it is standing on the sidelines. I got no candy at the parade last year. And we love a parade in church as well, don't we? This parade, otherwise known as Palm Sunday, that we celebrate each year, because who doesn't love a parade? And obviously, the parade goers that day, they loved a parade too. But it wasn't the parade itself. They were in love with Jesus. And that's why they showed up. Because he was the one and only float in the parade. There were no marching bands, and as near as the scripture tells us, not even candy was thrown from the back of a horse cart. They were in love with Jesus. The kind of love that in that parade almost bordered on the sort of infatuation that would be exhibited for a rock star or an athlete. They spread their coats on the road, for it was dusty and dirty. They took leafy branches from the fields, and they had cut them, and they waved them, and they spread those on the road as well. And those who went on ahead shouted, "Hosanna!" They did not shout, "Woohoo!" I'm sorry. But they shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord." And had they crossed a bridge, they would have rocked that bridge to the core as well that day. You know, most parades, of course, are given for a reason. It's a holiday like the 4th of July or maybe Memorial Day, part of homecoming festivities. Well, this Palm Sunday parade, although it seems like it was a spontaneous gathering of people on the edge of town as Jesus was coming in, it seems to have come off spontaneously with all of the outpouring of people along the road, but this was a parade that was planned. And who do you think orchestrated the parade? Jesus himself. When you go to Navy Pier in Chicago, at least before they were doing the current renovation, you'd happen upon all sorts of entertainers along the boardwalk. There would be jugglers and comics and fire eaters, and my favorite were the ones that were dressed in gold. You see them and they look like statues. You think they're a statue until somebody unsuspecting comes up and they move their eye or they move their hand and it startles the tourists. That's called street theater. Well, Charles Campbell has said, a Bible scholar, that Jesus in this particular parade is orchestrating a piece of street theater on Palm Sunday. Make no mistake, it was a carnival atmosphere that day as Jesus came into Jerusalem. But Jesus was also staging an elaborate parody. And he was the producer, the director, the screenwriter, and the actor all in one. We have to remember, and it's crucial to understand Jesus this way, that the people in the day, as Anne suggested to the children, were expecting someone to come and save them, and they were expecting a king. And in the day, the king meant a military ruler. They were clamoring and pleading for that kind of ruler who would save them from the oppressive military power of Roman rule in Jerusalem. Just like today, they expected that their leaders would lead them into a military battle and a military victory, because that's the only way you would ever outrun your opposition and overthrow the empire. You see, these ideas aren't modern. They go back into antiquity. So Jesus began his procession at the Mount of Olives, which is the traditional place from which people would have expected a military campaign for Jerusalem's liberation to begin. It's as if a parade today would begin at the Pentagon. You know what kind of parade it is. That's the kind of parade that they were expecting. But Jesus did not adorn himself with war armor or ride in on a majestic war horse. He chooses instead to ride this traditional war path on a colt. Some of the Gospels call it a donkey. Imagine Jesus, this full-grown man, sitting awkwardly side-saddle on top of a pile of old clothes on a colt with his legs dangling down and perhaps even dragging on the ground. He certainly isn't coming off as a military hero. He He looks like one of the poor and the downtrodden and the vulnerable who were actually lining the parade route. And through that act, Jesus was communicating his intent to both the political powers and those who were oppressed by the political powers. Because physically and spiritually and emotionally and personally, Jesus aligns himself with the least among us. He chooses not just to stand with the poor, but to join them and walk with the poor, no matter where the road leads. Back in 2003, Palm Sunday, which that year had this very same reading from the Gospel of Mark, Palm Sunday fell on the first Sunday following the United States entering into Baghdad and troops pulling down the statue of Saddam Hussein. Perhaps you remember those images. It's hard to believe that that's been 15 years. So this very text from the Gospel of Mark was read on that Palm Sunday. And the juxtaposition was stark and clear because the march on Baghdad and the Palm Sunday march in Jerusalem were very different kinds of marches. Now today, this Palm Sunday follows by one day the March for Our Lives that was held in Washington and several cities around the globe. This next slide shows a picture of the gathering yesterday in Washington, D.C., 10 blocks spanning out from the Capitol. As you probably know, yesterday's march was led by a group of students from the Marjorie Douglas Stoneman High School in Parkland, Florida, who have emerged as a national anti-gun voice in the wake of the shooting that left 17 of their fellow students dead. And these student leaders, sharp-tongued and defiant, are hoping to elevate gun control as a key issue during the upcoming midterm elections and, importantly, to inspire their peers to register to vote. And the students are saying, never again, and enough is enough. Well, some people have mocked and ridiculed the students for their so-called idealism and their naivete. I try to imagine how a 17 or 18-year-old musters enough courage, composure, and poise to stand in front of hundreds of thousands of people and eloquently plead for peace in our day. I couldn't have done that at 17 or 18 years old. And then I think about Jesus, open to being mocked and ridiculed for his Palm Sunday parade for some of the same reasons that those in power branded him a naive idealist and irrelevant until they found out that he was gathering quite a following, and then they became scared because he was standing up for the poor and the downtrodden and the oppressed and the hurting and the dying and the recovering, only further insulting those who were in power. And so you know what those parade goers were shouting on that Palm Sunday? Woo-hoo! No. They were shouting Hosanna, which means, loosely translated, come save. Hosanna. Come save us. That's what they were yelling after Jesus. Come save us. It's not a word that we hear very much, not even in the church. We mostly just hear it on Palm Sunday. As far as I know, no one shouted Hosanna at the March for Our Lives yesterday in Washington or any of the other cities that hosted that march. But you know what? They were crying out to be saved, weren't they? Who among us could stand confidently enough, proudly enough, invincible enough to not need to turn to Jesus and say, come save us? Hosanna. This past week, as we concluded our FaithLink Cafe, our annual gathering of food and conversation during the weeks of Lent, we brought out our question box again and we invited people to ask questions. Questions of God, questions of their neighbor, questions of their pastor, faith-based questions, the kinds of questions that make you wonder and you think, I've always wondered the answer to this question. And when we've done this every year, there are certain patterns to the question. There's some questions that come up because they're the kind of questions that we know are universal, that most of us have. The Reverend Dr. Scott Black Johnston, you can see him on this next slide. He's a pastor of Fifth Avenue Presbyterian Church in New York. I occasionally want to put the pictures up so you don't believe I'm making these people up. These are real people. So he was a pastor in church, and he did a similar exercise, but he was doing it with a group of seventh graders. And so they were talking about salvation, and one of the questions was, is Jesus the only way to salvation? And those were the questions that they were talking about. And so the pastor, and he says, being an annoying pastor like he was, before they answered that question, he wanted to ask them another. And he said, since salvation implies that you're being saved from something, what do you think Jesus saves you from? And what do you think that the seventh grade student said? What would you say? What does Jesus save us from? They said, because they had learned properly in their confirmation class, presumably, that Jesus saves us from hell. Which isn't a bad answer. That's a pretty biblical answer, in fact. But Pastor Scott was thinking about it, Scott Black Johnston, and he was thinking, and he thought, maybe it's not just that simple, though. He says, I don't think the people who were lining the streets of Jerusalem on that Palm Sunday were primarily concerned about hell that they were shouting out to Jesus to be saved from. What they wanted to be saved from was the Romans, who were making their life a living hell. They wanted deliverance from an occupying army. And so he continued to challenge those seventh graders, and he said, okay, that makes sense, and you understand Scripture well. What else? If God was on the ball and God was paying attention to your life, what would God save you from? And suddenly, he said, the conversation got very interesting, because as the students started to get away from the answer that they thought the pastor wanted to hear, well, one of the youth raised her hand, and she said, death. Another one that said God could really help by saving him from an upcoming math test. Then one of the seventh graders said, pressure. Another youth said, my parents' expectations. And then another shy young person, almost in a whisper, said, fear. I want God to save me from being afraid. Pastor Johnston said, you know, those answers struck me as perhaps more sincere than Jesus only saving us from hell. Hosanna. Say it once. Hosanna.
Hosanna.
What in your life would you shout for Jesus to save you from? You don't have to say it out loud. Can we dip down into our souls and be as honest as those young people were as we gather with our palms along the dusty road where Jesus is walking into Jerusalem? They did not know that day where the story would lead. For better or worse, we do. Because their shouts of acclamation and adoration for Jesus on that Palm Sunday would soon lead to the Last Supper with his disciples on Thursday evening. And they would lead to the trial, the mock trial, the sham trial that would lead to his crucifixion on Friday, which we recognize ironically as Good Friday, only to be shaken alive again on Easter Sunday. That is the week in which we are about to enter from this place. What begins this day is the irony of beginning with a parade and ending in pondering. They didn't know yet what was to come. Jesus did. We do. We've read our scripture. We can see the church calendar. We can look at the bulletin to know that our Holy Thursday service is 6:30 this week, and our Good Friday service is 6:30 this week, and our Easter Sunday celebration begins on that West Long at 7. We can understand all of that, but these disciples in this parade and this day with those cloaks and those palms did not know what was to come. What they knew is that they needed a Savior as much, if not more so, than all of us do so today. And so can we, with the honesty of those young students, the seventh graders in Reverend Johnston's confirmation class, or the thousands of students from Parkland, Florida, and around the country, including Milton, who gathered yesterday? Call them idealistic and naive, but what is their cry? Their cry would be, Hosanna, come save us. Friends, in this Holy Week, I would invite you to ask yourself, what do you really want God to save you from? Save me from anger. Save me from cancer. Save me from depression. Save me from debt. Save me from the strife in my family. Save me from boredom. Save me from getting sent back to Iraq or Afghanistan. Save me from the endless cycle of violence. Save me from humiliation. Save me from staring at the ceiling at 3 a.m. asking, why do I exist? Save me from bitterness. Save me from arrogance. Save me from loneliness. Save me, God. Save me from my fears. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even on a cross. And there, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
As creator of all things, God made everything on earth for a purpose. You see, it was always his plan that his only son would die for the sins of mankind. So he created the minerals that forged together would become the spear used to pierce his side. He created the brambles and briars from which would be fashioned a crude crown of thorns that would pierce the flesh of our Savior's brow. And he alone would create the tree, which would become a cruel instrument of torture and death. Upon that tree, his ultimate expression of love would be offered. It's like
sheltered it with moss.
He grew the tree that he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing in his life with love he gave it. He was crucified on a tree that he created.
tears in his eyes. God looked down through time, saw him spat upon, rejected and mocked. Still he grew the tree that he knew would be used to make the old rugged cross. Nothing took his life with love he gave it. He was crucified on a tree that he created with great love for man. God saved with his plan. He grew the tree so that we might go free. He grew the tree that he
Jan and Betty and Julie. Our prayers this day for ourselves and others, and we are privileged to bring them before God this morning, and so I would ask in the moments we have in worship today, if there are prayers that you would lift today of joy that you have experienced in your life, or joys that you are anticipating, or perhaps concerns that you would lift this day. And I begin by offering a prayer request on behalf of Don and Donna Bain. Don has had a long winter of struggling and has been hospitalized recently. And I share with you this morning that Don has come back home, but he is on hospice care. And so I would invite your prayers to be with him for his rest and comfort, and with Donna, for whom, of course, this is quite the ordeal, and the rest of their family. I want to lift prayers for the music students of Milton High School who left at 4 o'clock yesterday morning on their way to New York City for a week of exploring and singing. And prayers for our student democracy, I can't remember the name of the program, the week of democracy in Washington, D.C., and several of our students, including some from this congregation from Milton High School and from this church, have been in Washington, D.C. this past week. What other prayers might you lift this morning? Yes, Judy.
Continued prayers for Sue Pecker as she recovers from her cancer surgery. She's doing quite well.
Sue Eckert recovering from cancer surgery. Prayers continue to be with her during her recuperation. Sharon?
For Linda Vassette as she faces surgery this week.
Linda Vassette? Having surgery this week, cancer surgery this week. Thank you, Sharon. As part of our prayer time this morning, I would also like to invite my wife, the Reverend Ann Scott, to come forward. She has news to share, which is a good cause for prayer. So, yeah, if you'd like to. I would never speak for you, Ann. I think I would like to invite you to share this in your very own words.
Honey, we're having a, never mind. I have a conversation with our cabinet, our bishop, and our district superintendents. I have felt a call to local church ministry over these last 6 months or so, having served as the United Methodist Hospital Ministries chaplain for the last 2 years. Really feel that I am called to a local church, and part of that has been because of you and because of the welcome I've had and the opportunities I've had here. after their discernment and mine, they have graciously offered an appointment for me at Evansville United Methodist Church. And so I will, July 1st, be serving at Evansville as the full-time pastor at that congregation. We're very excited about this. Steve and I served in ministry together earlier up in Chippewa Falls when we were serving in the same circuit. We were within community, close communities with one another. So we did circuit ministry together, and this is just a real blessing for us. As many of you know, with the appointment process being what it is, clergy basically sort of put our lives in the hands of the cabinet and the bishop and hope that they know what they're doing, and not so much that they've got a dartboard with a name on it that they're throwing a pin at.
Bishop Jung, if you're watching the video, just erase that.
And so we really trust in the discernment process for the cabinet. One of the things that Steve and I were really clear about was that his ministry is vital and is thriving, and there's exciting things going on here at Milton. And so we asked that we be considered for an appointment for me that would keep him in close proximity to me, but also to be continuing as the pastor here at Milton. So for the near term anyway, we're going to be here for a while, and we're very excited about this. So.
True story.
True story, yeah.
It's a true story. Bishop's not here. I don't have that authority.
No.
As you know, the career change for Ann was brought about by Jill's passing a couple of years ago. She had been a full-time pastor for several years prior, and God has continued to bless us with this chaplaincy opportunity, but it was very clear to us, perhaps even before Ann, that her calling was to lead a congregation and to help. And so we're really grateful for Evansville. I just want to be clear. I'm staying. She's going to Evansville, and I'm sorry to disappoint you about that. As we all know, being a pastor means you have to wear many hats. And so this one says Evansville, and you can wear that hat proudly. And as you know, she is a cheerleader, and so this is an Evansville Blue Devils megaphone that says go team. Not sure you're going to need the megaphone when you get to Evansville, but you've got it just in case.
Do I have to share the hat with you since you've got the collection?
It's all yours. Friends, let us join together in prayer. Oh, gracious God, we celebrate this day that all of us are called. Some to ordain professional ministry, but so many more of us, oh God, are called to be a Jesus follower right where we are, in our families, in our workplaces, in our communities. God, I ask that your call on each person gathered here today be made continually clear so that we can follow you more nearly. I celebrate Anne's ministry and the call that you have put on her life and ours collectively, that we may be blessed as we are to continue to serve people in this Rock County area of Wisconsin. And I thank you, O God, for this congregation with whom it is such an honor to do ministry with. But God, we always get to the end of our days or the end of our rope. And sometimes with Jesus, we have to get off our high horse and get close to the ground and perhaps to our knees and bow to say to you, God, save us. Save us from that which we cannot fix ourselves. Save us from the world and its ways which sometimes oppress and discourage. So God, even as we are called to encourage one another, we come before you as we enter into this Holy Week, praying to be saved. Hear the unspoken prayers of our hearts this day, O God. And hear us as this Jesus whom we follow, whom we meet on the road, teaches us how to pray in the words that we now join together in saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And now let us continue our worship by the offering of our tithes and gifts. Let us give generously our good and the good of all of Christ's church.
Be seated.
Go to the last slide. And then now go to the internet. Nope, keep that up. Just click on the internet, Dad. It should be a YouTube video. Okay, just hang on a second.
During the final song, we invite you to remain seated, to be with God in prayer, to ask that God might save you and save us, and that we might follow Jesus' steps this week to come and always. And when the song is over, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.